Welcome to worship this morning on the service for the third Sunday of Easter. We begin our worship with our opening hymn, He's Risen, He's Risen. And as we sing and as we hear the readings, we're reminded of this. As people who know that our Lord Jesus died and rose again for us, we have a meaningful message to share. May God bless our worship today. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins, and purify us from all unrighteousness.
Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Holy God, gracious Father, I am sinful by nature and have sinned against you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved others as I should. I deserve your punishment, both now and forever. But Jesus, my Savior, paid for my sins with his innocent suffering and death. Trusting in him, I pray, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Our gracious Father in heaven has been merciful to us. He sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, by the humiliation of your Son, you lifted up this fallen world from the despair of death. By his resurrection to life, grant your faithful people gladness of heart and the hope of eternal joys. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated. At this time, we would have our brief children's sermonette, so if there are any small children that would like to come forward and talk to me up here in front, they could do that now. We're going to have a lot in the late service because the small kids are singing. But look, there's a bunch here too. There you go, Mr. Schreiber. Thanks for leading the way. There are some other ones. One, two, three, four, five, six. Six little tykes. And Mr. Schreiber is not a tyke. Okay. I'm going to bring something down here to show all of you, okay? Because I don't think you'll see it next week. Ready? Here it is. I'm going to bring this. Ready? Why won't you see them next week? Because some are getting a little like that. What is this? Do you know what this is? It's a flower. It's a plant. What kind of plant is it? What color is it? White. Well, it's always green, but then also white. So does anybody know the name of this? It's called an Easter lily. And they are white. Three of these are white. They're only up here in front of church at Easter time. Does everybody know why? Do you know why? Because it's an Easter plant. So every time you come to Easter, the day that we celebrate when Jesus rose again from the dead, when you come into church, you can smell them. Yep. And you'll see them up in front, and they'll be all white Easter lilies. And does anybody know why? You know what? I'm not positive of all the reasons either. But let's see if we can think of some of them. What color is it again? White. See? There's white everywhere. On the time of Easter, that's the color for Easter, is white. It shows, I don't know why they pick white, but it shows that white shows that Jesus rose and lives, and because of that, all of our sins are forgiven. Sins that would stain us were purified in the righteousness of Jesus. White. Jesus lives so that we can be promised that we're forgiven. What does this kind of look like? Here's another thing. Let's say I actually could take this one off and use it, but let's say I went like this. What would it look like, kind of? Yeah, it kind of looks like a horn, kind of like a trumpet. Because Jesus lives and we have something to announce. And that's what a trumpet does. And sometimes you hear those musical instruments at Easter time too. It announces that Jesus rose and lives again. One more thing. Now this is probably the main thing. Do you know what's down in there? Dirt. Get right. There's dirt in there. But what's in the dirt? A seed. Do you know what they call a seed for a plant like this? It's the same as a light up there. What's in those things? Light bulbs, right? So the seed is like, I don't really know what it looks like. It's like a big round seed, and it's in the ground. And I could cut this off. In fact, somebody's going to take these home and do that. Cut them off and plant that seed in the ground. And guess what's going to happen next year? It's going to grow again, isn't it? It's going to come up and rise up. That's what Jesus did, didn't he? When Jesus died on the cross, where did they put him? They put him in a tomb. But what happened on Easter? He rose again from the dead. He comes to life and lives. He still is alive, isn't he? So that's what this plant reminds us of. Okay, you think I got their attention still? All right, ready? Should I put this back where it goes? But when you see this white trumpet-looking flower, it's a reminder. Whenever you see one, be reminded, Jesus lives. Yeah, that's a good point. This one's still growing. It's going to go like this. Open up. And it's always a reminder that our Lord Jesus lives. And that's good news for us. Good news to share with people, isn't it? Like a trumpet. Okay, you want to go back to your seats? Okay, you'll go back. Should I put this plant back where it goes? Okay, all right, I'll do that. I'll face it this way. Okay, ready? You go back. I'm going to put this back, and then I'm going to go read the Bible readings for the day. And we'll be reminded in our Bible readings that we do have a message to share. A message to treasure, and a message to share. The first scripture reading is going to serve as the basis for our sermon meditation today. And it's from the book of Acts, the history of the growth of the Christian church after the resurrection and ascension of Jesus. And we'll start at Acts chapter 5. The apostles were brought in and made to appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name," he said. "Yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood." Peter and the other apostles replied, "We must obey God rather than human beings. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. God exalted him to his own right hand as Prince and Savior, that he might bring Israel to repentance and forgive their sins. We are witnesses of these things. And so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. When they heard this, they were furious and wanted to put them to death. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We chant Psalm 117. Second reading from the first letter of John. We'll begin at chapter 1, verse 5, and into chapter 2. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word is not in us. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. On the night of the first Easter, the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 24. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have. When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it, because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Dear Christian friends who live your lives in the reflection of Easter, we'll go back to Acts chapter 5 for a meditation. That incident when Peter and John are standing before the Sanhedrin proclaiming the saving name of Jesus. Would you have liked to have been them? Do you think that, in general, being a witness in a public setting is something that you think you'd be good at? Or that maybe you'd shy away from? You know, like, let's just say, of a crime or something, or a trial. Would you make a good witness? Or it wouldn't have to only be a trial. It could be some big event, some major storm blows through, or something happens that's a big spectacle, and the news reporter people are there, and they got their cameras, and they got their microphone, and they're looking for somebody to talk to. Would you be intimidated by that? Shy away from it? Or would you kind of be the kind of person who would look forward to saying, you know what, I want to be able to tell what I've seen? A lot of people are reluctant witnesses. And probably for a couple different reasons. One might just be fear. One of the big fears that people have in life is, that's why they don't like public speaking. If you can speak to one person, you can speak to 100 at one time, right? It's the fear of looking foolish. If you're going to look foolish, you'd rather do it in front of one person than in front of 100 people. The fear of being judged by what you might say, or looked down upon by what you're testifying to, could make people reluctant witnesses at a trial. It could be even at a microphone at a news scene. Could also be fear of danger. If I say this, if I say what I know and what I actually believe to be true, it might even bring harm to me. Another reason that people are reluctant witnesses sometimes is they're just so unsure of themselves. Maybe I don't know it fully. Maybe there are some details that I would miss. Maybe there would be some questions that they would ask me, either on the witness stand or in front of the camera, and I wouldn't have a full answer to. I'm just not sure. Why don't you ask somebody else? So we meet Peter and John today in the lesson from Acts. And they are witnesses to a spectacular event. They had seen the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And as Peter said, we are witnesses of these things. But before we can get around to saying, good, I'm glad it's them. I'm glad that they're taking on that role, those disciples of old, and they wrote it all down for us, so I don't have to be the witness. Ask someone else. Peter reminds us, really, as we read through this account, we're all witnesses. We are all witnesses of these things. But we don't have to be afraid. And we don't have to be unsure, because the Holy Spirit is involved. So we'll look back again, but remember this. We are witnesses of these things. With Spirit-worked courage and Spirit-given truth. Are you and I really witnesses of the resurrection? We weren't there. We didn't see it with our own eyes. Remember last week what Jesus told Thomas, who said he had to see it to believe it? You're blessed because you see it. But blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. The only way that believing comes, whether it be for Thomas, whether it be for Peter, whether it be for John, whether it be for Isaiah who predicted and in such vivid detail the crucifixion of Christ, and those prophets who looked ahead to the living Savior, the only way that they have faith to believe is the Holy Spirit. On our own, we can't come up with that. It's the Holy Spirit that touches hearts and gives us the faith to believe. So now, remember what Peter said about the Holy Spirit and about us. He stands in front of the Sanhedrin, the ruling council, who have forbidden him to preach. And he said, we cannot help but speaking about the things we have heard and seen. And then he says, we are witnesses of these things. And so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. Those who obey him are those who believe. What does God want? What are the works of God? The work of God is this, to believe in the one that he has sent. We are witnesses of these things, Peter says, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who believe. The Holy Spirit is a witness of the resurrection of Christ. That's the Holy Spirit who lives in you by faith. You are a witness of the resurrection of Christ. You know through the eyes of faith that your Lord Jesus did die for you. And he rose again. As surely as those Easter lilies, will, when they're cut off, will come again through the ground, he who was buried, who was dead, is alive. As a promise that your sins are buried in that grave with him, and you rise to live a new life connected to Christ, a life of faith in the one who cleansed you from all sin, who purified you from all unrighteousness. You are witnesses of these things. You know these things to be true. A lot of times people are reluctant witnesses because they are afraid. What will happen to me if I say this? That's where we found the disciples in the gospel reading today. It was the first Easter night. All the goings on that had taken place. And where were they? They were locked away in a room, keeping a low profile, not out there in the public. Don't let anybody know who we are. I don't want to be seen as those who have been with Christ. I don't know what's going to happen to me if everybody knows that at this point in time. This is a dangerous world, a dangerous time to be a believer. They're in a locked room. But when they see Jesus, at first they're afraid, but then they're amazed and overwhelmed with joy. And especially 50 days after Easter, what happens? When they are clothed with power from on high, as Jesus said, just wait in Jerusalem until that special outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And they're emboldened, and they're not afraid. And they step forward. And the book of Acts will show us that. We read some of it. They'll step forward into the city again, and they'll say, I don't care who knows it, I want people to know it. I'm a believer in Jesus Christ. I know the one who died and rose again. They preached his name in the center of Jerusalem, in the temple itself. God had given them the ability to do things so that the message of those early proclaimers would certainly be noticed and believed. He gave them the ability to do miracles, healing miracles. And thousands of people became believers. They were forbidden to preach. They were put in jail and spent the night there. Twice that happened. They were out and now forbidden to preach again. The second time, they're in jail, and in the middle of the night, guards are all in place. Everything's where it should be. Nobody is the wiser. An angel lets them out of jail, middle of the night, and says, go back into the city and preach as Jesus has told you to do. The guards wake up. The prisoners, Peter and John, are not there. This is the words leading right up to our reading from Acts. They look around. They said, well, the doors are locked. The guards are here. We don't know where they are. Somebody comes running up and says, hey, those people that were in jail that you're looking for, they're in the temple preaching again. So they were arrested again, brought before the Sanhedrin, and forbidden to preach. That's where we see the Spirit worked courage. In Peter and John, the same Spirit worked courage that's in you. Not by your strength, but by the Spirit. Here's what the answer was when they were forbidden to preach that time. Peter and the other apostles replied, we must obey God rather than human beings. The one time, that's kind of the little rider attached to the end of our teaching of the fourth commandment. Remember, honor your father and mother and respect those in authority. If you owe respect, give respect. If you owe honor, give honor. Your revenue, that's tomorrow. The one time that we would disobey those in authority over us, in a position over us, whether it be a parent, whether it be the governor, whether it be my boss, is if they tell us to sin. Hardly ever happens, does it? But when it does happen, Peter says there's no choice here. We must obey God rather than men. Jesus Christ had commissioned. We'll see it later on in the Great Commission. Go and proclaim the gospel to all creatures. Jesus Christ has given his church, his believers, the privilege and the commission to share this meaningful message that Jesus died and rose again. Repentance and forgiveness of sins is the message. Lay our sins at the foot of Christ. There's no place else to take them. Turn from them in sorrow, but trusting completely in the cleansing blood of Christ. That's a message to share. And Peter says, no human court can overrule that. May God give us always that same Spirit-worked courage. There might be times when we are tempted for a lot lesser reasons than these apostles were facing jail or maybe even death, tempted to not maybe let our faith be shown on our sleeves, maybe not want to stand out from the crowd too much because this is a dangerous time to be a Christian. Maybe not at this moment physically dangerous, though it could be. But at your workplace and in your social media and wherever we go, standing out and saying, I'm a believer in Jesus Christ. I hold to his word. I trust him with my eternal life is not a popular message in today's world. But it is a meaningful message. May God give us the boldness to be able to say it or to live our lives in such a way that people can recognize it in us. How will they know that you are my disciples if you love one another? By the way that we live, by the way that we act, by the priorities we have in life. May the Spirit help us to stand out from the broken world around us as people who know where we're going. The world is so confused, is it not, spiritually speaking? You know what's right and wrong. You know what happens with the wrong. You know what you deserve because of it. But you know that Jesus paid that price for you. And that's the truth. Paid completely. You know that Jesus rose again from the dead. And he said, because I live, you also will live. When the day comes for you to die, you know where you're going. You don't hope you know where you're going. You do know where you're going. Same for your loved ones who have gone on ahead of you. That's why people will notice at the funerals of your Christian loved ones that they'll say, I don't know how you stay so calm. You're still sorrowful, but you're also calm. Your light is not under a bushel. It's being seen with Spirit-worked courage. You are witnesses, just the way it is. You know Christ who lives. Another reason that people are sometimes reluctant witnesses isn't fear of how they might be perceived or what might happen to them, but maybe it's just an honest feeling of being unsure what to say. You don't have that problem either. You are witnesses with a Spirit-worked truth. Peter filled the room with the name of Christ that day. They said, you're trying to make us, you're painting us with this brush that we're guilty of this man's blood. Well, of course you are. You're filling the whole streets with his name. Yes, they were. And today he filled that courtroom with that Sanhedrin with the name of Christ. In response, he says, boldly, the God of our fathers raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him to his own right hand as Prince and Savior, that he might give repentance and forgiveness of sins to Israel. Hopefully some of the people in that room were listening that day instead of hardening their hearts against that truth. Yes, they did kill the Savior. We all did. By our sins that caused him to be nailed to that cross. It was Christ who was killed by the will of his Father. It's God who really placed him on that cross so that we wouldn't have to suffer that punishment. In mercy and in grace, but we're all culpable. But Jesus came and died and rose again so that everybody in the room of that Sanhedrin that day and everybody in this room today can have that gift that he might give by faith, repentance and forgiveness of sins. And that's what we have. That's our truth. That's a new phrase over the last couple of years. I got to tell my truth, as if everybody's got a different truth. Our truth is the truth. Spirit-worked truth. Jesus died and rose again, and your sins are forgiven. And heaven is your home. And that's a message. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, not only for ours, but for the sins of the whole world. That's a message we can share with anybody. May we live our lives holding to that truth, being filled with it as you come to God's house to hear it, and that truth will find ways to come out in your words and in your examples as you live in this world. Are people afraid to be witnesses? Sometimes. Are they unsure of themselves? Sometimes. But you don't have either problem. When it comes to the resurrection of Jesus, you are witnesses of these things with a spirit-worked courage and a spirit-given truth. May God bless you as you go forward as witnesses to the light in this dark world. Amen. Now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We continue with the confession of our Christian faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Heavenly Father, we are gathered today to give you thanks that your Son, Jesus Christ, carried his cross to his death for us, that our sins might be paid for and our eternity secure. We thank you for his resurrection from the dead, which assures us that all is complete and we are at peace with you. We thank you that in love you not only gave your own Son, but along with him graciously care for us every day of this life. This is a message to share. Give us courage and confidence as we live in a broken world that is so hostile to the gospel, that our example and our words might help guide souls to your side. Bless those we love as they face any individual challenges. Preserve our church and school in your grace, and give success to the word that is proclaimed and taught. Keep our city, state, and country in your care, preserving lives from danger and allowing the gospel to be freely shared for the preservation of souls. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen. At this time, we'll receive our offering of thanksgiving for the Lord. During that time, we'll watch the Wells Connection video. Gives examples of some of the ways our offerings are used. Following the collection and the video, we'll join in the next hymn.
I'm Wells President Mark Schrader. Serving the needs of those around us can be a great way to show compassion and love to people when they need it most. It can also provide an opportunity for us to tell those we're helping about Jesus. Thanks to a grant offered by Wells Christian Aid and Relief, congregations can receive some financial assistance in their efforts to show love and compassion to people in their communities.
Caroline, you're small.
Christ Alone Lutheran Church, just outside of St. Louis, was looking for a fun way to get children into God's Word, as well as serve their community at the same time. The result? Camp Compassion.
We've done other things in the past, like a fitness camp and a drama camp and things like that. But I think that we have kind of hit on something here in the idea of compassion, where we kind of put it out there to the community that, you know, we all want our kids to grow up to be kind, compassionate, thoughtful people. Thank you so much for joining us this morning for Camp Compassion. I am glad that you could join us.
Through their one-day event, children learn about the compassion that Jesus has for them and how they can express that compassion to others.
And then we give them the opportunity to actually put those principles into practice by packing the groceries that are going to be delivered to people in the community that are in need.
So as you walk through the line, you can even keep track of how many items you put in there.
I think it's great that they think about other people. You know, some places don't.
Wells churches, like Christ Alone Lutheran, can carry out compassion ministry with financial assistance from Wells Christian Aid and Relief, which offers a $2,500 matching grant to congregations for this type of ministry.
This program is designed to encourage and support congregations who are reaching out into their communities with the compassion of Christ by helping people with their real needs, whether it's, you know, food, clothing, shelter kind of needs, medical care, mental health care, whatever it may be, whatever they're doing to help people who are hurting.
Congregations have used these matching grants to support pregnancy counseling centers, food pantries, and like Christ Alone, providing groceries to those in need.
I think lots of other churches could do this because I think, specifically the gift of groceries, I think food insecurity is becoming a greater and greater problem across the nation. I think normally we think of urban congregations, right, with inner city and urban neighborhoods as having a greater need for this kind of thing, but honestly, rural communities also have need.
We are situated in a nicer suburb of St. Louis, and this is a pretty affluent area, but there are still pockets of people that are in need. I think that the stats showed that 15% of the population here in our county struggles with food insecurity.
This grant from Wells Christian Aid and Relief can help congregations to more than they normally could.
Thanks to Wells Christian Aid and Relief, we can do a little more than just, you know, rice or bare necessity kind of things.
We're a small congregation, and we have had overwhelming support from our congregation for this purpose, but making something like this happen without their help would be really difficult for this congregation. We would be able to do some, but because they can come in with the help that they do, we can even do more.
What we found out over the years is that actually doing the work of helping people who are in need really serves the ministry of sharing the gospel, because it gets us into contact with people who need Jesus. I'm really encouraged to see how Wells and Wells congregations have begun more so to embrace the idea of compassion ministry. It's always been there, but I think now we've become more open to it and more people are doing it, and it's bearing fruit, and we're getting to share the love of Christ.
Have a good one.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
If you're a part of a self-supporting Wells congregation that would like financial assistance in carrying out compassion ministry, you can apply for a grant at wells.net/relief.
Blessed Lord, you have given us your holy scriptures for our learning. May we so hear them, read, learn, and take them to heart, that being strengthened and comforted by your holy word, we may cling to the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace.
Amen.
Please be seated. Refreshment and time for study in between. Our Kingdom Kids Sunday School is in between services as well. That'll take place in a short while in between services, but please stay a little bit for fellowship if you can. All announcements are in the announcement sheet, which you haven't seen it yet. You can pick it up on the way out at the usher's table. We do have a letter from the pastor that we had called, and you've probably seen by now he has declined that call. He will be staying where he is. His name was Pastor Carl Schrader. He writes, "Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, after prayerful consideration and while weighing the needs of ministry here in Sturgeon Bay, I have decided to return the divine call that your congregation extended to me and continue serving as pastor at St. Peter's. I have enjoyed the opportunity to reflect on this calling, and it truly has been a blessing to go through this process. My wife, children, and I wrestled much with where I could best serve him. God has blessed you with a wonderful church and a wonderful school and ministry team. I really appreciated getting to know your ministry there. It's easy to see the Lord's guiding hand and blessing on your mission, and I know that he will continue to guide and bless your church. Your school is a special place where the love of Christ is on display daily. I also pray that in the meantime, you will continue to grow in your faith in Jesus and be encouraged in your life for Jesus. Your congregation and Crown of Life Christian Academy will continue to be in my prayers as we look forward to seeing God's plan for you revealed. Thank you, and may God richly bless you in the days ahead. In our Savior's service, together with you, Pastor Carl Schrader." So we'll go to the next step, and the next step has already been decided, and that is, because of the time of year that it is now, the graduating class of our seminary will graduate in May, and so we will place a request for a graduate. That's a call that we've made to the assignment committee of our synod, and we'll see. There is certainly no guarantee at all, because there'll be many requests like that too across our synod. But we were encouraged to go ahead and make the request anyway, because however the ministry needs synod-wide match up with the different candidates available remains to be seen. We'll let the Lord work on that. So stay tuned for that. At our academy, there are vacant positions for teachers also. We have several aide positions. You'll see those listed in the news and notes. There are also looking for some teachers in the preschool section of our academy and also in the first grade of our academy as well. So that's not unusual to our church body now. There's a lot of needs for teachers and pastors, but the Lord of the harvest promises. We pray to him and let him provide, and we trust him for that. So that's the update on that. Everything else you can see for news in the sheet. God bless your week. Enjoy the day today, and we'll see you next time. Thank you.